Hi, I'm Travis, and this is Curious Tangents. And here in America, it's an election year, which means we can't stand each other. Here in America, we have two political parties, except not really. There are more than two parties, but Democrat and Republican are so dominant that all of the other parties are referred to as third party. And the last time that a third party candidate won more than 10% of the vote was 1968. Regardless of if you're in America or someplace else, you probably identify your politics as more liberal or more conservative. And political parties also align themselves on different positions on that spectrum. But how did you get to be where you are on that spectrum? How did your political party choose you? But first, back in 1912, there was a man by the name of Emile Durkheim. He was a philosopher, and he coined the term collective effervescence. Many a soldier has gone to the military believing that marching was a mindless exercise, to come out of it understanding that marching bonds them to the people next to them. If you were to scan the brains of all those soldiers marching, you would notice a shocking amount of similarity. This can be seen in synchronized swimming, group yoga, religious rituals, and more. It's referred to as muscular synchronization, but it's also, in a way, neural synchronization. Though the more interesting feature of collective effervescence might be oneness. It's the feeling of awe, or losing yourself in a crowd, no longer being an individual. But how individualistic are you? The weirder a person is, the more individualistically they tend to think. And if you're watching this video, you are probably very, very weird. By which I mean Western, educated, industrialized, rich, and democratic. Meaning that if you're a part of my audience watching this, you are disproportionately weird. The weirder that a person is, the more they tend to perceive individual objects rather than the entire picture. As opposed to people who are, quick note on sociology, we made this acronym WEIRD to describe a group of people that most studies are based on. And this group of people is not representative of the entire planet. We did not make an acronym for everyone else, and so I'm going to refer to everyone else as normal people. And people from more normal societies tend to view the world and images in a more holistic way, perceiving not just the objects, but the relationship between the objects. Though this doesn't stop at images, more normal people tend to perceive social issues as they relate to the world around them, not as problems that affect individuals. However, this video is focused primarily on America, and America is overall a pretty weird country. The best indicator of what a person's political beliefs will be is the political beliefs of their parents. I know, not an interesting answer. However, there are some interesting relationships between your political party and your personality traits. One of the most well-known is that conservatives tend to be more conscientious, whereas liberals tend to be more open. But the personality traits go a bit deeper. People who are better at detecting threats or have larger amygdalas, the portion of the brain responsible for threat detection, tend to be more conservative. When 9/11 happened and the world seemed incredibly threatening, and whenever the world seems incredibly threatening, politics tend to shift to the right. Your personality is in large part genetic, and that's not anything particularly groundbreaking. When I say this, I mean the big five personality traits, the underlying dispositions that make up who you are at the core. The lowest level of your personality, or the dispositional traits, are the same as the big five personality traits. These are traits like openness, which liberals tend to rank highest in, conscientiousness, which conservatives tend to rank highest in, and then extroversion, agreeableness, and neuroticism. Similarly, morality, our moral codes, can be split up into six different dimensions. First, there is the Care Harm Foundation. Everyone cares about this, though liberals tend to rest more of their foundation upon this, fostering a sense of community and kindness with your peers and the world around you. Two is fairness in cheating, designed to get rid of free riders. In any situation where resources are scarce, such as the majority of human history and still many parts of the world, it's incredibly important that everyone is pulling their fair share. Three is loyalty and betrayal. This is in large part the basis of tribalism. The more cohesively a group or tribe, or, well, company, can work together, the better they are at outcompeting the groups and tribes and companies who cannot work together. Basically, the lone wolf dies, the pack survives, and the well-organized and cohesive tribe thrives. Human beings are amazing hunters. We are small and physically unimpressive, yet a group of us can take down mammoths. It's thought that humanity didn't just outcompete other species. Humanity also outcompeted most of humanity. Neanderthals, who inhabited Europe and the Middle East a few thousand years before us, were also prolific hunters for tens of thousands of years. And within a few thousand years of interacting with us, they were all gone. They were better adapted to the cold, they probably had bigger brains than us, they were definitely more muscular, and they probably had language. And yet, we outcompeted them. It's thought that Homo sapiens also did this to other Homo sapiens. Our ancestors aren't just those who lived in groups, but the most tribalistic of them. More cohesive and cooperative tribes outcompeted those who were not, and so our ancestors are the most tribal of the tribalistic. I won't romanticize us making species go extinct. That is a tragedy, and we must do better. However, I do find something beautiful about the fact that biologically and socially, we were designed to do our best work together. Fourth is authority and subversion, or respect for legitimate authority figures and undermining of those who are not, most easily seen in the overthrowing of dictators throughout history. Number five is the category of sanctity and degradation. This is most commonly stated as my body is a temple, or cleanliness being next to godliness. It's thought to have evolved as a way to protect us from contaminants. And six is the newest of these morals, both evolutionarily speaking and research-wise. The Liberty Oppression Foundation came into being around the time that humans learned how to use tools and then weapons. Before this era, it was thought that whoever was physically strongest would have simply dominated all of the groups. However, once everyone was armed with spears, we needed to organize ourselves in a different way. We became more egalitarian in what is often called reverse dominance hierarchy. When people say that things are innate, we tend to think that that means that they are both universal and inevitable, but that's not really what innate means. All that something being innate means is that it was structured in advance of experience. The reason that I can teach language to a baby and not to a chimpanzee is because babies have genes for language. Their brains were structured to learn language. However, if that baby is never taught language, never spoken to, as we know from studies of feral children, then that baby will never learn language. Ergo, language is not inevitable. And the language that that baby learns, down to the dialect and the way that it's spoken, is dependent on the environment that the baby's in. If you're born into America, it's extremely unlikely that your first language will be Scottish. Similarly, morality and political ideology are innate characteristics. A baby who has genes which disposition him towards a love of structure and order, and a larger amygdala, or a better threat detection system, is far more likely to be conservative, while a baby born with a tolerance towards novelty and a disposition towards being more empathetic is far more likely to be liberal. Even if these two were siblings and went through very similar situations, such as growing up in the same house, going to the same school, and living in the same community, they would likely end up with different political values. This video was based heavily on the research of moral psychologist Jonathan HAIDT and the team over at moralfoundations.org. I highly recommend his book, The Righteous Mind, if you'd like to know more about stuff like this, or yourmorals.org if you'd like to know where you fall on any of the six matrices. A quick reminder, I have a Twitter, and if you like this video, like and subscribe, and thank you for watching.